The original ending of Syriana was George Bush going into Congress, and I was going to use actual footage from the Iraq War Declaration, and he's going to declare war on Iran. So, in other words, the end of the movie would be the actual president of the United States declaring war on Iran.
Right.
Okay, in 2003, this goes up the flagpole, you know, at the studio and with the producers, and everyone's like, you're insane. We're getting along great with Iran. There's not going to be any war in Iran. What are you talking about? Meanwhile, you know, my number one, you know, cohort and source for most of this stuff is the ex-Iraq bureau chief, you know, Bob Baer. So all his pals are like Iran hands, and they're all these guys who've spent 25 years. And so what's coming down to me is like, it doesn't matter what's going on now. They have a nuclear program. And the minute they start looking like they're going to test a bomb, gloves are off, and we're in a new day. They all said to me from the first moment of research on Syriana, Iraq is a sideshow. So in 03, you know, I was trying to fight for this ending, and it was just, it was incredibly hard. So anyway, you know, do I think it's relevant? I mean, you know, absolutely in terms of what's going on with Iranian policy, that Iran is coming back to the center of sort of our Middle Eastern policy, and it got ejected for a little while. But then, you know, and on the other side, it's just gas prices. You know, you fill up your car and it's $75. And I think that, you know, this is definitely, you know, as gas goes to $4, $5, $6 a gallon, which is inevitable, you know, the politics and the policies that underlie Syriana, you know, have to become more relevant. I mean, just have to. They hit your pocketbook, so you go, wait, what was that crazy movie about, you know? It was Fat Clooney. I don't know, he was like angry about something.
Yeah. It seems to me that our thing with Iran is because the Unocal pipeline didn't work, and we need their northeastern border with Turkmenistan. That's key, the Caspian gas and oil reserve.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. I spent a lot of years, obviously, researching this and reading about it and talking to people, oil men and European, you know, secretive money guys and people that do seem to have their hands on levers that I didn't know existed. And you can analyze all, you know, really you can analyze geopolitics from a financial perspective. And then there's this kind of flip side that says, well, you don't really believe it's just about oil, do you, Steve? That's so naive. It's not about that. It's about the fundamentalist driving policy and thinking there's going to be last days on the shores of Jerusalem. Or it's really about a re-election strategy that, you know, no president in a time of war has ever been unseated, so you have to have a war, you know. And so, anyway, there's the money side, and then there's kind of like this amorphous, it's all these other things. And you go, all right, we put these incredible sanctions into place against Iraq. Iraq has all this energy in the Western Desert. No one knows what's out there exactly. It hasn't really been surveyed properly. But there are rumors of Saudi-sized pools of energy underneath the ground. Well, during our embargo phase, where no American companies are allowed to trade with Iraq, what's happening? What's happening in Iraq? I can tell you what's happening. The French are trading with Iraq, the Russians are trading with Iraq, the Japanese and Chinese are trading with Iraq. And so America has now got last seat at the table. There's not even crumbs left for us. So in a post-embargo world, post-92, you know, we don't get any of that energy. Unless what? Unless you reset the table.
Yeah.
And if you reset the table, then all those agreements and alliances are thrown out, and now it's open, and obviously, you know, our Halliburton-run government will have first dibs going in. Now, I'm massively conflicted by this because I'm also a huge beneficiary of the standard of living in the United States. I know what it means to be able to get in my fucking 66 GTO and go cruising around with a top down on the LA freeways. So it's not easy to point fingers. It's complicated. But I'll tell you, the minute I threw out all those tortured arguments for the Iraq War and suddenly said, well, what if we're just resetting the table for energy?
Yeah, follow the money.
You just go, suddenly, like, you're not confused anymore. You go, oh.
Following the money.
If they'd just been honest, I swear to you, if the president of the United States went to the country and said, listen, here's what happened, you know, and we need this oil. We need it. Look, you're driving an SUV. You think you need it? You need it. I think America would have gone, all right, I buy that,
yeah.
You know? It's in our national interest. But there's just all this tortured, hidden, sneaky bullshit covering it up that drives you crazy.
As a citizen, not a filmmaker, what did you learn from Syriana?
That's an awesome question, because it was really just one jaw drop. I mean, the research phase, where I got to travel in Europe with this CIA officer, ex-CIA officer, but 23 years as a CIA officer, and I started a network through his Rolodex, essentially. And you meet these kind of, you know, global oil and arms guys, you know, and very early on, I kept hearing this quote, and it was so amazing. They said the oil business and the arms business are the same business. It's the same business. Get it through your head, Steve. It's the same business. And I'm like, huh? What? They go, no, the dollar figures on arms deals are too big. You know, governments don't write checks. You want to sell like $14 billion worth of, you know, fighter jets to some country. You don't go, well, here's a check for $14 billion, thank you, and deposit it, you know, at the Citibank. It's like what happens actually is oil's traveling on a bunch of tankers headed some way under a Liberian flag. That oil's owned by X company. Suddenly it's under, you know, it's under one government flag in a partnership with three people. Suddenly the flag changes, the ship changes direction, and the payment for these jets comes in energy. You know, energy and arms, you know, the bullet and the oil are the same thing. And I was just like, and these are the guys, you know, that are, have their own 767s, you know, have the $100 million estate overlooking Geneva. And you tend to take them seriously.